You know what you need to do? Dare to believe God. Amen.
And have faith. When have you seen a thing happen like this anywhere? Not anywhere around this nation. It hasn't always been easy. He's had the tears and he's had the sorrows and the sleepless nights and the opposition. Sometimes opposition of people who were supposed to be for him. Amen. Just remember this, people. You can't always depend on the saints. Sometimes, preacher, your most bitter criticism will come from those who make the most pretended piety. Tomorrow morning, let's have a great crowd in Sunday school. Last Sunday morning, in Greenville, South Carolina, we had 1,425 in Sunday school. I'd like for us to have it. Tomorrow morning, let's have a great crowd. And when you come, stay for church. If you can't go to both Sunday school and church, then stay away from Sunday school and go hear the pastor preach. Because it's pleased God by the foolishness of preaching, not by foolish preaching, but by the foolishness of preaching to save those that believe. And sometimes we've emphasized this Sunday school business till we've got the tail wagging the dog. The Sunday school is okay. I know a big church down in West Virginia where they have preaching at 10 o'clock and Sunday school at 11. Preacher said the Sunday school is not, the preaching is not the dessert here, it's the main meal. Amen. Stand and sing "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." Just two verses, everybody. Stand right up, one at a time. That's the way. Amen. Says, have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. We usually take it everywhere else but to Him. We take it around the country. We take it to our neighbors, but we just don't cast our burden upon Him. He careth for you. Sing it when you're everybody. Have we trials and temptations?
Have we trials and temptations?
Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for the Lord Jesus. Not only our sin bearer, but our burden bearer, who invites us to bring all of our problems and our burdens to Him. We thank Thee tonight for these people that have come over from Newark tonight, and for these that have driven up from Ironton and its environs tonight to be here in this meeting. We pray that Thou would bless them for their trip and give them mercy, journeying mercies, we pray. And use us tonight in this message, because we ask it in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen. Open your Bibles tonight to the second chapter of the book of Ephesians. The second chapter of the book of Ephesians. Wherefore remember, that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh, made by hands, that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. These words that I just read describe the appalling condition of the Ephesian Christians before they were saved. I want to call your attention tonight to two little words that come to us out of the dark background of this picture tonight. And those two words are these: no hope. Perhaps there are no words in the English language that have a more dreadful meaning than those two words. Doctor stands beside the bed upon which is a very sick man, finger upon the sick man's pulse. Anxiously the family awaits the verdict, and presently he lifts his eyes and says to them, "Prepare for the worst. There is no hope." Yonder is a ship that has sprung a leak at sea. Madly the waves rush across the deck of the ship as the sailors work away feverishly at the pumps. And finally the captain said, "There is no use. There is no hope." Now those are dark words in connection that I just used them, but they're darker still in the connection that we find them in this text tonight. Far better had a man be without anything else in this world than to be without hope for a future life. You may be in great present distress, but if you have sure hope for the future, that amounts to but very little. You may be in great present prosperity, but if you have no hope for the future, that amounts to but little. I want to preach to you tonight on three classes of people that I shall describe, who stand absolutely without any hope. But before I tell you who they are, it might be well for us to explain what we mean by the word hope. We use the word hope in a very careless way. God always uses it with the greatest of care. Desire, no matter how strong that desire may be, is not hope. Mere expectation tonight is not hope. Hope, according to the Bible, is the well-founded, well-grounded expectation for the future. There are three classes of people tonight who have no well-grounded, well-founded expectation for the future. May I tell you who they are? First of all, the man that doubts or denies the existence of God tonight stands without any hope. Because man's only rational hope for a future life rests upon the existence of an intelligent, beneficent, omnipotent God ruling in nature and in the affairs of men. Take him out of this universe tonight and man stands absolutely hopeless, and a very dark hell may be his portion at any moment. You say, "Dr. Lincoln, do you believe that there is anyone tonight that doesn't believe in the existence of God?" Well, not many. But that amounts to very, very much. But I've met a few little... hells around over this country that proceeded to tell me that they did not believe in the existence of God. But I met one day Charles Evan Smith, the president of the League of Atheism from New York City. And sitting in his room in the hotel, I said to him, "Mr. Smith, do you believe in theistic evolution?" He said, "No, sir, I do not believe in a God at all." I said, "How do you account for everything that is?" He said, "Everything that is just happened to be. Like I would take the letters of the alphabet and cut them to pieces, throw them up in the air, and they would just happen to become the 23rd Psalm. Or I would take this watch with all of its intricate mechanism and say that back of this intelligent creation there was no creator. Back of this design there was no designer.
It came into being by its own efforts. And then he said to me, I do not believe that I exist, either in mind or soul. I said, I will admit the mind part of it. I don't know about your soul. I will admit myself, I think you're a non-entity when it comes to brains. Then I ask him this question, and I want you to get it, some of you young people. I said, Mr. Smith, do you believe a theistic evolutionist could be a Christian? Well, he said, absolutely not. I said, why? He says, because evolution says that man did not fall. He climbed down out of the trees and started to walk. He said, if man did not sin, he doesn't need a savior. He said, did the monkey sin? So therefore, when you have destroyed the Garden of Eden, you have chopped down the need for the cross of Christ. You have chopped down the need for the cross of Christ. And then he said this. He said, any man who is an evolutionist that stops short of atheism is simply a dishonest thinker, that's all. You say, Dr. Loken, do you believe that? Do you think there is a God? I don't think I know. I am as sure there is a God as I'm certain that I'm standing up on this platform tonight. And I know it, first of all, for this reason tonight. I know it from the act of creation tonight, from whence did everything come that you see tonight. Life has never been generated from dead matter. Nothing from nothing, nothing could ever come. Suppose I'd take a bottle tonight and I'd cork it up till nothing is in it and nothing could get in it. From nothing, nothing could come. How would anything ever be in it? That's what we call a complete vacuum. Nothing in it and nothing can get in it. You say, well, I don't believe in a complete vacuum. Well, if you'd followed me over the world for 45 years and looked into the faces of a lot of things I've had to preach to, you would believe in it in this time. Nothing in it and nothing can get in it. The old lady said, I didn't get anything to take home with me. I said, you didn't bring anything to get it in. That's what's the matter. Listen, now then, I said, from nothing, nothing could come. Suppose that away back yonder in the dim, distant past, there was nothing. There was nothing. From nothing, nothing could come. There was a time when God was alone in the world. There was no trees. There was no leaves. There was no grass. There was no water. There was no nothing. Just God. He is the... Oh, someone said, Dr. Lipkin, every effect has to have a cause. That isn't true. They said the Bible says in the beginning God. The Bible didn't say that. The Bible didn't say in the beginning God. The Bible says in the beginning God created. God didn't have any beginning. God was the beginning of beginning. By Him all things were made. And without Him, there was nothing made that was made. You hear people talk about natural law and spiritual law. There is no such a thing. The thing you call natural law is God's thought and will in nature. The thing you call spiritual law is God's thought and will in spirit. But it's God. That's the reason, then. I have no other explanation for all that is tonight. Except God. Except God. Second, I know tonight there is a God from the idea of imparted wisdom. You don't call it imparted wisdom, you call it. You don't call it imparted wisdom, you call it inherited instinct. There is no such a thing as inherited instinct. Fact of the matter is, no such a thing as instinct. Long in the fall of the year, pretty soon now up around the lakes, the geese and the ducks will all begin to assemble. And pretty soon they'll form companies and fly down over Ohio and Kentucky and Tennessee and Alabama and Georgia. drop their breasts in the warm waters of the Gulf of Mexico to wait until spring to spend the icy winter, and then spring comes, they'll turn and come back north again. Who told the goose to do that? Who told that goose to go north-south in the winter and come north in the spring? You said, that's instinct. Where'd they get their instinct, old goosey? Let me give you another one. Out yonder in California, they have a little spider about the size of a shoe button. And that little spider builds its nest inside an empty clam shell or oyster shell to rear his young, and before it does that, it lifts that from 6 to 12 inches from the ground. And for him to do that requires an engineering feat that's equal to the building of the pyramids of Egypt, because it's many, many times the weight of that little spider. How does he do it? He goes up to a limb and puts on a thread, comes down and hooks it on the side of the shell, goes up and puts on another, comes down and hooks it on the other side of the shell, and he keeps putting them on, he keeps putting them on, and that thread is moist, and when it dries, it contracts. He keeps putting them on, and they dry and contract until he lifts it. Where did he learn how to do that? You say that he learned that from his mommy and poppy spider. Where did they learn it? They learned it from theirs. Where'd they learn it? They learned it from theirs. Listen, old smarty. The first spider then that ever did that thing had to sit down and figure it out for himself, didn't he? It's not inherited instinct, it's imparted wisdom. That's the reason tonight, I know. There is a God. I can say why I know, because I'm not an educated man. Educated man not supposed to know anything. He's supposed to say perhaps, or it could have been. I'm like Lucy down in Georgia when they said, can you read writing? And she said, Lord, I can't even read reading. Somebody asked me if I could read Greek. I said, I can't hardly read English. Amen. One fellow was talking about baptism. He said, it's ram-tizo and baptizo. I said, yeah, grave, e, grave, I, grave, o, but you ever just sop when I was a kid? That's the only thing. I know! I know! You say, how do you know there is a God? I know it from another reason. I hold in my hand tonight, a book. We call it a book. It's more than a book. It's a library of 66 books written by more than 40 different authors over a period of more than 1,400 years. And in this book tonight, we have prophecy. Prophecy is writing history before it happens. Every religion has its Bible, but this is the only Bible of all the Bibles that has a word of prophecy in it. Why? Because the author of those human books had sense enough to know the day they stuck a word of prophecy in their book and it failed to come to pass, their book would be discredited. But this book, with daring boldness, tells you what will happen upon this earth, to men, to nations, to cities, to individuals, 1,000, 2,000, 4,000 years in the future. Who could write a book like that? Who could write a book like that? A man who knows his Bible tonight, you could give him a Bible and a paper and put him in a cave tonight, and he could tell you what was coming to pass on the earth, because it's written here. I can take the prophecies concerning Jesus Christ alone and prove. First of all, he said he should be born of a virgin. I believe that. Amen. Not a young woman. He should be born of a virgin. Your new Bible, and the new Bible is a bad book. Your new Bible said he should be born of a virgin. Why? Because that takes the deity away from it. The Bible said he should be born of a virgin. Thank God he was. Without a man in it. Then he said he shall be born in Bethlehem of Judea.
And thank God he was. I read the book of the umbrella. I've been reading that this week, and Mr. Foray says that they had to fabricate these things to make it fulfill the scriptures, because they fabricated the scripture that said he shall be born in Bethlehem of Judea. And he said, why should a woman 9 months pregnant be taken on a long, hazardous journey like that? He said, the fact of the matter is, he was more than likely born in Bethany. I think he's a liar.
Amen.
How do you like them apples? Let me tell you, I believe that he was born in Bethlehem of a virgin. Amen. Why? Because the Bible says so. You say, well, why did you say that harsh word? Because that's what the Bible says. Let every man be a liar, but God's word be so. Amen. He said they would pluck out his beard. They did. He said they would sell him for 30 pieces of silver. They did. He said he would make his death with the wicked. He did. He died between two thieves. He said with the rich in his burial, and he did. He was buried in a rich man's tomb. He said they would gamble upon his garments, and they did. Then he said on the third day he would arise again, and thank God he did. I went in on Easter Sunday morning of 1954. I went in the empty tomb and knelt down and prayed in Jerusalem, and I had the honor of preaching the sunrise sermon to the great crowd of people, tourists and so forth, in front of the empty tomb. And when I came in, I said the other day in Paris, they said, here's where Napoleon is. And in Egypt, they said, here's where King Tut is. But I said, I've just been in there. This is not where he is. This is where he was. Thank God he's out of the grave and he's in the glory. And he's coming! He's alive. How do you know? Because I talked to him tonight before I left the room up at the hotel. That's the reason I know. He came out of that tomb and said, I am he that was dead, and I'm alive, and behold, I'm alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of hell. I told you, my Catholic friend said I couldn't go to heaven without going in the Catholic Church, because St. Peter had the keys, and I said, let old Pete keep his keys. I've got the door. Thank God I don't need his keys. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. That's the reason I know. And I could stand here tonight and tell you that a son came up in the morning of the prophecies. On Easter Sunday afternoon, I went through the Mendelbaum gate and across no man's land and into Israel, and was received by Rabbi Herzog, the chief rabbi of the state of Israel. And I personally interviewed him. And he told me that he saw in the reestablishment of Israel, the state of Israel, he saw in that the fulfillment of the prophecies of Ezekiel 36, 7, and 8, so forth. I said, do you believe, Rabbi, that Messiah will be a person or a system of politics and prosperity? And he said, you can't have a system without a person. He'll be a person. How do I know there is a God? Listen to me tonight. I know it by another way. Have you ever gone into an automat? It's a restaurant that looks like a post office. I remember I was up in New York one day and I went into one. You don't see any cooks, you don't see any waiters, you don't see any waitresses, you don't see anybody. You walk up to a slot and you drop in a quarter, out comes some mashed potatoes and gravy. You drop in a dime, out comes a cup of coffee. You drop in 15 cents, out comes a piece of pie. You don't see anybody around there. So being a country boy, I tried it out. When I dropped in my money, out it came. But I wasn't big enough fool to believe there wasn't somebody back there passing that stuff out. Amen. Do you know why? No! There is a God, I'll tell you why.
Hallelujah. For 45 years, I've walked up to the open window of heaven and I've asked for things. And he's passed them out to me just as real as pie and coffee. I know there is a God because he answers prayer. That's the reason tonight. So if you're downhearted, look up. Jesus is on the throne. And the second man who stands without any hope tonight is the man who does not accept, believe this Bible as the Word of God. Many a man says, I'm not an atheist. You may not be. You may be a theist. Though you believe in God and yet deny the Bible as the Word of God, you still stand without any hope. Because man, by his own human reasoning and mere philosophy, has never been able to get an adequate conception of God. And the only revelation that you have of God that will give you an adequate foundation on which you can stand for a reasonable hope is the revelation that God gives of himself in this book. Little two-by-squirt said to me not long ago, said, you believe the Bible contains the Word of God? I said, no, I believe it is the Word of God. From the first word in Genesis to the last word in the book of the Revelation, in its verbally inspired, inherently accurate Word of God. And it's forever settled in heaven. It may not be settled in some universities, may not be settled in some colleges and seminaries, but bless God, it's settled in heaven. Amen. They don't have any modernism in heaven. I'm going to preach some of these days on, is there any modernism in heaven? No, they believe the Bible is the Word of God in heaven. They believe in the deity of Jesus in heaven because they saw him before he ever left there to come down here. They believe in the sacrifice of Calvary. Why? Because he went back up there and showed them his hands and his side, and he's there now with the scars on him. They believe in the resurrection too, because he's back up there. He couldn't have gotten back up there if he hadn't arisen from the dead. They believe in salvation by blood too. They believe in the atonement because he's the high priest that took it and he's now gone into the Holy of Holies and made atonement. How do you know the high priest is up there? Brother, how'd they know it in the Old Testament when he went into the tabernacle? How'd they know the high priest was in the Holy of Holies? I'll tell you why. He had on his garment, he said he had on his robe, a bell and a pomegranate. And they knew he was ministering. The crowd on the outside knew he was in the Holy of Holies because they heard the bell ringing. You know how I know my high priest up there? His spirit bears witness with my spirit, and I hear the bells are ringing. That's the reason I know. That's good cheap food, isn't it, huh? I'll tell you something tonight, that's the reason I know. But you say, Brother Lakin, he said, Mr. Lakin, the Bible's so full of contradictions. I said, show me one. Oh, he said, there's plenty. I said, I don't want plenty, just one. He stood and sputtered like an arc light. Then he said, the Bible's so full of contradictions. Show me one. Then he said, the Bible is so unscientific. That's a big word. Bible's 1,000 years ahead of science. I delivered a lecture once before the Tennessee Polytechnic Institute at Cookeville, Tennessee, on the scientific and historical accuracy of the sacred scriptures. Oh, I can give some of those, you know. Like when I was given an LLD at Kletzing College in Oskaloosa, Iowa, and I went there and delivered the educational day address. Now think of that, a dropout doing that. Fella telling me the other day, what an awful thing. I said, it is bad, I'm one myself. But when I got up to speak, I said, I don't know why the president asked me to deliver the educational day address unless he wanted you to see the need of it. I may not know a noun from a pronoun or a preposition from a proposition, but there's one thing I know. Once I was blind, and now I see. I know that. Amen. Let me tell you something tonight.
and after I'd finished my address at the school, I had 14 doctors of philosophy on the platform. One of the teachers of science said, "Dr. Lincoln, that's the greatest lesson in science I've ever had in my life. This Bible defiles, how long have we known the earth was round? Before we ever found it out, they knew it in the Bible. For he that sitteth above the circle of the earth." Why, even the second coming of the Lord proves the earth's round. Even the rapture proves that. Because he said, in the rapture, two shall be in the bed, one taken, two shall be in the field, one taken out of the left. See, the earth's round, so when they're in the bed over there at night, they'll be in the field over here in the daytime. Ah, the Bible. You don't have to be smart. Just take the Bible and let it say what it wants to say. Amen. You don't have to be smart. Why, my friends, listen. How long, where does all the water go that goes down in the river? It's been raining tonight. Where does it go? It goes out into the ocean. Why doesn't the ocean get full and overflow? Never gets any full or emptier. Why? Because the Bible says all the rivers run into the sea, and yet the sea is not full, for they return from whence they came. How long have we known there were germs? Before Mr. Pasteur ever discovered it, they knew it in the Bible. Did you ever go to a hospital? I suppose you've had your operation. If you haven't, you're a back number, amen? That's the reason I'm so high up the social ladder. I belong to the Royal Order of Scar Stomachs myself, my friend. Old women used to get together down home at a bean string, and they said, "That is just after my first child." Between the first and second. But when they get together in the hospital, when they get together around the bridge table now, she said, "That was just after my first operation." I remember they took me to the hospital, and a little nurse came in and took some blood out of my ear. Another came in and took some out of my finger. Said they want to make a blood test. Then the doctors came in. Had on white caps and long robes, looked like a delegation of the Ku Klux Klan calling on them. And when the jury went out, I knew I was convicted. They put me on that thing and wheeled me up there. Doctor says, "Don't be afraid now. I've operated 200 and never lost the one." I said, "Suppose you operate 201 and lose one of them. I'll be like the man who was nervous," and the doctor said, "Why are you so nervous?" He said, "This is the first operation I've ever had." He said, "Well, this is the first one I've ever done, so don't be scared about it." Here's what I want to say. The doctor came in after a while with a cloth like that around their mouth. You ever see them like that? The cloth around their mouth like that. Well, they knew that in the Bible before the medics ever found it out. You listen to what the Bible says. "And this shall be the law of the leper. He shall go down the street with a cloth on his upper lip. And if the wind blows, he cries, 'Unclean,' and passes to the other side." I preached this in Dr. Luther Peake's church, Wichita Falls, Texas. Said, "Dr. Lincoln, wherever you go, don't fail to preach the sermon on why I know the Bible is the Word of God." But you say, "Dr. Lincoln, listen, you know they used to bleed people for certain diseases? The man who treated George Washington took a quart of blood from him the day before he died. That may have what hastened his death. But now they give them blood transfusions. Why? Because the Bible says the life of the flesh is in the blood. This is the Word of God. It's the Word of God. Don't you be worrying about it tonight. This is the Book of God." You say, "Dr. Lincoln, do you believe the miracles of it?" I certainly do. "Do you believe the whale swallowed Jonah?" Who said it did? The Bible didn't. The Bible says God prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. Hebrew word, dag, meaning monster of the deep. Jonah had a custom-built boat for that ride. Of course, if you can create for yourself that big enough esophagus to swallow all the unbelievable tommy rock cast off under the head of pseudoscience, don't doubt the ability of an omnipotent God to make a fish big enough to swallow a man.
Somebody said, but the gastric juices would have digested him.
Isn't that so?
I don't think Jonah's walling around any whale's gastric juices. I think he was rambling around in there trying to find the place he came in, and God tickled the old whale, and he spit him up, FOB, free on bank. That's the first piece of free mail delivery we have on record. And Jonah started down the street pulling the seaweeds from behind his ears, met a man coming with a fishing pole, and said, go on down, brother Jonah, we'll have fish for supper. He said, shoo, no. Peter never cared for chicken after the rooster crowed. Jonah never cared for fish after the whale arrived. Prodigal son never liked pork chops after he got out of the pen. Let me tell you something. I could give you, if I had time tonight, give you a bigger miracle than that. If a man can make himself a ship and go beneath the sea, don't doubt the ability of God to do that.
You say you believe that Balaam's ass talked, yes, and the axe head swim, yes.
I do. When you place God positionally where God belongs, nothing becomes impossible. Let me give you another one tonight. The man who denies Jesus Christ as the Son of God. Man said he, even if Jesus was God, he was half a sinner. He said he was only a human because he went to sleep on a boat. Said he was only a human because he got hungry. Said he was only a human. Said he was only a human because he wept. He was only a human because he died upon a cross. He was a human when he went to sleep. He was God when he stilled away.
If he was a human when he got hungry, he was God
when he took a little boy's lunch and fed 5,000 people with it. He was a human when he wept. He was God when he raised Lazarus from the dead. He was a human when he died. He was declared to be the Son of God with power by his resurrection from the dead. The man who doesn't accept and confess Jesus Christ as his personal Savior stands without any hope. You see, I believe in God. I believe Jesus. That's not all of it. Have you trusted him? Have you confessed it? If not, there is no hope. No hope for the life that now is. That is, tonight, you have no guarantee of continued life if you're not a Christian. Every step you take is along the edge of the grave, and that may crumble any moment that you go in. You read the paper this afternoon where the man went out to the creek yesterday to wash his car, missed the little five-year-old child, and they presume he did. And he couldn't swim, and he dove into the water to rescue, they presume, the child. And they both died, and through the long hours last night, they dragged and hunted and finally found the tube of it. Now, when he left home with his little child, he didn't think that. He didn't think that. You say, Dr. Lakin, I'm going to get saved before I die. You may die suddenly.
You have no guarantee of continued life.
You have no guarantee of continued prosperity. You could be worth all that your heart could wish tonight and lose it within the next 48 hours. Fact of the matter is, I think most of your big fortunes will be swept away within the next 10 or 15 years, either by some social or political upheaval or by the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then you have no hope of continued capacity to enjoy your prosperity if it should continue. Christian, if you're not a Christian, you haven't any right to claim one promise in this book. Man was worth $1 million, sat down and ate a cracker and drank a glass of milk. He couldn't buy a new stomach. Let me show you something tonight, my friend. You have no hope for the life that is to come. Did you ever go and look in the grave of a godless man and see how dark it is? As they lower the body of a godless man into the grave, how dark it becomes.
Then you have no hope of ever meeting with your loved ones that have gone or who may go if you're not a Christian. The believer loses his loved ones, but he doesn't sorrow as those that have no hope. Because he knows the time's fast hurrying on when the Son of God will descend from heaven with a shout, and the voice of the archangel and the trump of God shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, ever to be with the Lord. If I could have my way, I think I'd like to be living when sometimes I think I'd like to die and go through the whole process. Then sometimes I think I'd like to be living when Jesus comes. And if I'm living, I'd like to hold a meeting like here or the one I had down yonder at South Point. Then I'd like to go up yonder, stand there in Wayne County in West Virginia under that big oak tree beside that little mound that contains all that I ever had. Stand there for a moment when they begin to get up, and I said, "Good morning, Bill. Good morning, Mother. Good morning, Dad." Then one blessed eternal good morning to Jesus. Don't take that hope away from me. Now put your crutch under my arms as I struggle on. Don't take that away from me. My hope is built in that. Then another thing. There is absolutely no hope of pardon in the eternal world. It's offered you tonight. There'll be none offered you tomorrow. What you do about the salvation of your soul, you'll have to do before the wood of the cradle ever bumps the marble of the tomb. Listen to me. I love to preach. I love my friends. I don't have many, but I love them. I tell them around the country. I've met the leaders of politics and religion around the country. I've flown over the deserts and the wheat fields and the oceans. I tell them many times the land that looks best to me is a few acres over yonder in the hills. And I've met the leaders of religion and politics. But Brother Teddy, I'd rather have my neighbors and my people and my friends like you to think well of me than anything else in all this world. And if Jesus doesn't come and I go, I tell my wife to take, have my body brought back to the little country cemetery. And let my friends gather and pay their last, and let them have the last respect to pay. I know I'm saved, amen. Had a letter from my wife today. Just had a letter from my wife today. You know what she said? Well, I won't read it all. I'm glad you're going to have the delegation from Ice Creek Church and in that vicinity Saturday night. They really do like you, don't they? Amen. Anybody don't like me just don't have good taste. Amen. Hallelujah. Let me say this to you tonight. What you do, you're going to have to do this side the grave. Mother said to me, "Brother Lakin, pray for my boy." She knelt down beside the coffin. I said, "Honey, it's too late. Too late." That's the reason I'm spending every day and every ounce of energy and effort I have trying to get men and women saved. Because what I do, I'm going to have to do pretty soon. And what you do, you're going to have to do quick.
God help me to literally wear my life out.
So, let us stand.